When did you teach?
So.
Thank you for, thanks for coming tonight as we continue our commitment to working with our students and our families for the college application process. Our guidance department has really been doing the good work of really revolutionizing kind of how we deliver the important information that is needed. And tonight is the second workshop from the event we did back in March. And tonight's focus is really looking at the next steps in terms of summer, preparing for that beginning of senior year, and a really very busy time when we get back to school in the fall, which will be here before you know it, in terms of getting our seniors ready for those applications and deadlines and things. Just to share a couple of things for you, and at the end of tonight, I asked if you want to take a peek. In front of you is our Future Strong Wall that we just actually put up maybe just a few weeks ago. And it's really our program that we're starting here about looking for our students to celebrate where they're being accepted. And this wall, for every place that our students have been accepted for the class of 2017, and we need to go back and put some more on as more acceptances are being updated in Naviance, that all of the college logos and seals are being placed. And the idea is that as our graduates every year, we'll be adding more and more universities and colleges to that Future Strong Wall. So if for our juniors, you can go and take a peek at the places in the country that our seniors were accepted. And then this wall over here to my left is the Finish Strong Wall. That for the class of 2016, that at their National College Signing Day a year ago, all of their photos were done and their places of where they're going, and they make a commitment. And even though they're finishing strong with us, it's all about their new start, us starting strong, their new journey in life. And for the class of 17, their National College Signing Day is taking place this coming Friday. So all of our college graduates and, all of our college bound two-year, four-year technical colleges will all go here. And then when you came in the wall in the building this evening, you saw the American flag, and we were just waiting for the icons to come in, and then all of the branches of the military will have their icon up above that American flag. And then for all of our students that are going to serve our country, their headshots will be there on the wall. And working with the American Legion, that will be the senior portrait, and then when they finish their boot camp experience, we're asking the families to send in their headshot again of them in American uniform. And those pictures will stay together through their 4 years of their service, and then we will transition their photos down. So we're really excited about doing that. And the hope is that will be done by Flag Day, as the Legion and I are working on a potential opportunity to celebrate that space in our school. So on behalf of the entire faculty and staff, I welcome you tonight to this really informative event. And I want to turn it over to our guidance counselor, Steve Goldman, who really has been instrumental in really taking a peek at how we have done our work of sharing out the important information and the how-to and the step-by-step, and really trying to put it into a process that is really going to be user-friendly for our students who really have to own this experience, but also for the partners of the parents and guardians who will be the ones guiding along and prodding and maybe doing some of the applications themselves. So and thank you very much, Steve.
Well, let me welcome all you for all you. Yeah, appreciate you all coming out. It's such a nice day today. I know it's a busy month. There's a lot of things going on, but we do thank you for coming, and hopefully you'll find this informative. It is entitled "What Should You Be Doing Over the Summer." It actually is what you should be doing now into the summer. So we'll talk a little bit about what you should have completed at this point and where you should be moving. Did everybody get a workbook when you came in? Okay, for the students that are here, you can give that one to your parents. You'll be getting one in your advisories on Friday. Every junior is going to get one. Are there people here that weren't able to make it here for the Part 1 workshop that we did in March? Okay. If you go to our website, and it's inside, it's here on page 3 of the workbook, what we covered and what we asked that the students start working on between March and now. If you weren't able to attend that night, you go to Monroe High School website, click on the guidance link on the left-hand side, and click on Junior Information, and there you will see, you can print out a copy of the first workbook. This workbook that you have tonight is a completely different workbook. There is very little repetitive information from workbook one. which was entitled Where to Begin. So you can go to that one, and they look very similar in style and all that. So you can go there, you can start with that workbook. We also videotaped that evening, so you can see the presentation also. It was a great panel discussion that we had. It was very informative, a lot of questions were answered. So that's how you can play a little bit of catch up. If you haven't done too much, you really need to start now. Senior year is coming up very quickly. It's still very doable. You do not want to wait till you come back in the fall to start this process. You will either do a very sloppy job and not end up at the school you want, or maybe submit work that isn't representative of you and the time you could put into it. You just don't need that stress. You're going to be seniors. You really want to enjoy your senior year and have some fun also, and not have to sit there and fill out all these forms, write all these essays and all that stuff. So hopefully this will help keep you on track of things. If you go to the inside cover of the workbook, we have a timeline. And this picks up in May. The other one started back in March. The college fair the National College Fair was last week, last Monday. We took 80-something juniors into Boston, and there were, I think, about 400 colleges around the world there. It was a great event, so the students had a good time, and hopefully they got some information. It's going to help them making the decisions. There was a May SAT. If you have not signed up for the SATs yet, if you didn't take a May SAT, we really strongly encourage you to take the June SAT. Now, the deadline just passed to register May 9th, I believe, was the deadline, but there was a late registration deadline that's coming up very quickly. There is a late fee that goes along with that, but you really should get one set of SATs under your belt before you go off for the summer. We do recommend you take them twice. The second time, you should take it either October or November, depending on when your college applications are. If you're applying for November 1st or November 15th, you're probably going to want to take an October SAT. If your deadlines are after that, then November one would be perfectly okay. We'll talk a little bit about testing in a few minutes. So at this point, you should continue researching your colleges on Aviance. And starting to narrow down your lists. And of course, keep up your grades. You want to make sure that you're finishing as strong as you can. Moving on to June 3rd is the next SAT. And June 10th, there is an ACT if anybody's interested. That's the other college entrance exam. You don't have to take both. Most of our students take the SATs in the spring, and then later on decide whether or not they want to take an ACT. Make sure that you ask a teacher, at least one teacher, if they'd be willing to write a letter of recommendation for you next fall. Do not wait until the fall to do it. Some of them may want to start that over the summer, where they have time in their hands, and they can put some thought into it and not have to grade papers in the fall and have a million other things they need to do and maybe do a rush job, which won't serve you well. Make sure you get a commitment from a teacher. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a few minutes. And most importantly, like I said, keep up your grades. And then ask your guidance counselor for any questions before you leave for the summer. So you want to make sure that you get a bunch of that, those questions answered. I've got questions about your May SAT scores. Those results will begin before we leave for the summer. The June ones, unfortunately, you'll probably get just as we're leaving for the summer, so you may have more questions about that. July, continue visiting colleges. Write a rough draft of your essay. Start checking to see if colleges that you're applying to have posted their fall 2017 freshman applications. Set up an online account with the colleges, and you can also set up your Common App account. I'm not sure when the Common application is going online this summer. Sometimes it's usually right after, it's somewhere between right after the 4th of July and the 1st of August. We haven't gotten that information yet, so as we get that, we'll pass that along to you. So you can just go to commonapp.org and check in if you says fall admissions 2016, you don't want to touch that one, that's this year. You want fall admissions 2017. And start filling out the applications. There's no reason why you can't start answering the questions now. You will probably need your parents or guardians to help you answer some questions that maybe you don't know, like where they went to college, or what their level of education is, or what their middle name is, or their date of birth, and how old they. It's amazing some of the things that you may not know about your parents or what they do for work. So it's important to make sure that you have them as a resource while you're around me at the time. August, you want to review and update the forms that we're going to talk about tonight. And to make sure that the forms are the activity sheet, the letter of recommendation information sheets for your teacher and for your guidance counselor. You should be starting those now. We'll talk about that. But over the summer, if you've had some new and interesting experiences, you want to make sure those things are updated and saved in Naviance. You want to, in August, register for, again, either the October or the November SAT before that deadline comes up and before the test center fills up. And you may want to start a rough draft of your essay. And not have to stress out about that later on. You will want to attend the MHS College Application Boot Camp. It is two different meetings. The week of July 31st to August 4th is one of them, and the week of August 7th to 11th is the other one. You don't have to attend both. It's the same information, but that'll be an opportunity to get the bulk of your applications, essays, all taken care of, so you just can kind of clean up things when you come back in the fall. In September, we're going to have the senior workshop, and that's a bolt of applying to college. So at that point, the searching should be pretty much over. The list should be pretty much finalized at that point, and it's what do you need to do, what does your guidance counselor need to do, and how are we going to make this, get all this information out, and what do your teachers need to do, how are we going to get this information out. Your GPAs, which will include all your grades through 9th, 10th, and 11th grade, will be uploaded, and will be recalculated and uploaded into Naviance. So we will make an announcement when that is, when the new ones are actually up and running. Your grade point averages up through your sophomore year have been posted in there in Naviance right now, so you can see what it is. And in September, you want to coordinate with your English teacher and ask them to proofread your essay. Make sure that it is it's flowing and it is it's perfect. You certainly can ask one of the guidance counselors to read too. Just keep in mind that we are not English teachers. But we'd be reading more of a content. Your English teachers will catch the grammar and the spelling and all the other things that you might not catch. So that is the timeline. Page 3 is just a review, like I said earlier, of what we've done, what we did in the last workshop, and what you should have been working on. If you go to page 4, the testing information. So, we took out the SATs and the ACTs that have already passed, and this is what's coming up, so you can plan. If there's an asterisk next to the test date, that means that we are a test center, so you can take it here if you register early enough and there's a seat available. So we are a test center for the December ACT and the November SAT and the November SAT subject tests. As we spoke about earlier at the last workshop, you cannot take the SATs and the SAT subject tests on the same test date. The SATs take the SAT reasoning test takes the whole time. The SAT subject tests, you can take up to 3 of them in one sitting. I probably wouldn't recommend doing more than 2, but before you even sign up for a subject test, check with your colleges and find out if they even want them. There's probably about 75 colleges in the U.S. that require SAT subjects, and maybe another 75 that recommend them. My advice, if they're not requiring or recommend them, I would not take them. although you have, the College Board gives you the option of score choice, so you don't have to report scores if you don't like them. There are a few colleges out there that will say, we don't care what College Board is doing. If you want to come to our school, you're going to show us all of your test scores. So let's not take stuff just for the sake of taking them. More is not better in this case. If you're not sure if you should take one, or which one to take, if colleges are requiring one, depending on what subject it is, I would probably talk with the teacher that you've had for that subject. So there's two different math ones. There's a whole bunch of them. There's different science ones, biology and chemistry. You want to make sure that your teachers can probably tell you which one would be the more appropriate one for you if you need to do that. If you have questions about testing, please talk to your guidance counselor. We'll be happy to walk you through that process. Moving on to page five. Doing a good job moving this along. This is one of the forms that you're going to have to fill out for, this one's for your teachers. How many of you here have an older sibling that has gone through this process already? Okay, so this is a little bit different from what they did. As Mr. Brannigan said, we took a look at what we were doing and we've updated a few things. So in the past, there was one form called the autobiographical sketch that you filled out for your guidance counselor and your teacher. What we've done is we've actually changed it because we're talking with the colleges. The colleges really don't want your teachers writing about your softball experience if they're not your coach. They don't want you writing about the art project, the thing you did in the art club. They want the teachers to write an academic reference based on your experience in the classroom with them. So the form for the teacher, which is now called the Teacher Letter of Recommendation Information Sheet for Teacher, will focus specifically on your engagement in the classroom with the teacher. The second one that you'll fill out for the guidance counselor, which we'll look at in a minute, is the Letter of Recommendation Information Sheet for the guidance counselor, which will include the academics, but it will also include the extracurriculars because we write the all-round letter of recommendation and show you as a whole person that's going to be an active member of their community when you get there. You do not need a million letters of recommendation. Again, this is another case of more is not better. In most cases, they're going to want one academic and one official school recommendation, which is the guidance counselor usually. So you don't have to ask three or four teachers to do this. You don't have to ask an employer. They do not want parent letters of recommendation. I've seen some of those before. And what are you going to say about your kid, right? Don't take. So the colleges will tell you, Naviance will tell you also, how many they're looking for, minimum, maximum. Just because they say they have a maximum of three doesn't mean you need to give them three. If they say a minimum of one academic, then give them one academic and get the guidance counselor. If you get two teachers that you think are just unbelievable and you can't make your mind up and you think it's going to really make a difference, then you can consider asking two or three, depending on the college and what they're looking for. But in most cases, like I said, one academic, one official school, and you will be covered with that. So the teachers, as I said, are going to highlight your academic performance. When you fill out this form, please take the time to put some thought into it. Whether it's this form or the guidance counselor letter of recommendation form, please don't give us one-word answers. Okay? You don't have to write the Great American Novel, but you're really going to get out of this what you put into it. If you give us one-word answers or you skip questions, you're not leaving us a lot of stuff. Your teachers may not remember every little detail about the experience they had with you. Your guidance counselor sees you on occasion throughout the course of the school year. They don't see you every day. There's a lot of stuff we don't know about you. And it's important for us to include that all-around stuff when we're writing it. So, you know, if you're talking about an athletic experience, talk about not just something that you played a sport, but, you know, the experience you had with the team. Or, you know, maybe it was, you know, the extra work you put in to improve, you know, and to become a better player. You know, just give us, the general rule of thumb is more than two or three lines, but nothing more than a short paragraph for each section. So state what it is, give two or three examples of why it was a significant experience, and then you can move on. If you have two things you want to talk about, you can, after you do the first one, list the second one, give a couple of examples, move on. If you do that, again, you know, they only want us to write one page, they only want us to write one page. So we got to take all this information and really make it flow into a one-page letter of recommendation, play with the margins and the font sizes and all that stuff and everything to make that work. But it's better to write more than to write less in a case like this. So we'll be more than happy to, we'll decide what we feel best fits and goes into the letters. One of the questions on the guidance form is, what's your proudest accomplishment? And the response that we get over and over and over again is, my proudest accomplishment was getting an A in my history class. Does that tell anybody anything that they can't read in the transcript already? Why was that a proud accomplishment? That's the important piece. Okay, maybe that was not your easiest subject. Maybe you had to go for extra help, or you did a study group, or you had a tutor, or you had an extra credit. That's the stuff the colleges are interested in hearing about. Okay, so it's the experience behind it. Okay, so that is that. On page 8, we talked about the activity sheet a little bit. At the last workshop, it looks a little different because who might you ask? We talked about having teachers. If you know what you want to major in, possibly somebody that taught you that subject, so you're thinking about majoring in biology, maybe a biology teacher. However, keep this in mind. When you take biology, what year? Freshman year, and you're going to be seniors. Is it a good idea to ask a freshman teacher for a letter of recommendation? You've probably grown quite a bit as a student, right? So maybe that teacher is teaching another class that you've had as a junior or you're having as a senior. At that point, that would be a very appropriate person to write a recommendation for you because they can talk about the growth they've seen in you from freshman to junior or senior year also. So it's usually junior teachers that write the letters of recommendation. And the reason for that is they've seen you for most recently for the longest period of time. Senior teachers, depending on when you had them, may have just started with you. So after a month and a half of being with that teacher, they really don't necessarily have a good feel for where you're at and what kind of student you are. So think about it. If you're not sure, talk with your guidance counselor and we can help work you through that process. Okay, so the guidance counselor, right? The activities worksheet. So I was saying, we changed this up just a little bit. The color of it and the header. The reason for that is this is not only this gets submitted to you guys' counselor also. It's a little bit more information and more recommendation. But this is something we're actually going to start the freshmen with. And every year they're going to go into Naviance and update it. So you're not going to sit there as a senior going, well, so they didn't run as a freshman. It'll be, and it's, in a sense, it's kind of like a resume. So you'll have all this information. And for those of you that need to put a resume together, if you're doing internship next year, school career internship, and your resume is all your information right there on the sheet. If you're applying for a job, it's going to want that. I want a resume. There's all your information. It'll be very easy to plug into a resume form. Even in the near future, in addition to giving us this for your college application, your college recommendations, this document is now going to be the official document that you submit with your scholarship applications too. Most of the scholarships want a list of your activities on Middleborough letterhead, and this is going to be the form that you're going to use. So it's one less thing you're going to have to worry about in the spring when you're applying for scholarships. Get it already done. All you need to do is print it out. All these forms, the guidance counsel form, the teacher form, the activity sheet, are in the document library in Naviance. That's the link in the upper right-hand corner when you log on to your home page. And the instructions are in Workbook 1 on how to access that. So all those documents are in there. After you fill out those forms, save it to your hard drive or to a flash drive, then go into the About Me tab in Naviance, and when you click on that, you scroll down to the bottom where it says Journal, and you click on Journal, and all the instructions are in Workbook 1. You click in Journal, and you will add that document in. You can even do that with your essays for college. You can save those in Naviance. Any correspondence or any Word documents that you are doing college-related, you can save in the Journal, so you have everything in one spot. Naviance is what most students use now. That's how we send our transcripts out. That's how we send the letters of recommendation out. Everything goes electronically to pretty much 99% of the colleges through Naviance. If you're applying to Mass Maritime or Massasoit, those are two schools that still don't use Naviance. Well, they're in it, but they don't. We can't submit things electronically. So Naviance is really kind of your brain for the whole thing, it's a great tool. One little thing too. After you save all those documents into Naviance, if you go back in, you can edit them, but if you click save, it will not save the document in Naviance. It'll just revert back to the original document that was in there. You have to save it outside again to the hard drive, to flash, and then pull it in as a new document. So what I would do is I would just put a date next to each one so you know which one's the most recent updated one. The essay. This is one of the most significant parts of the application package. It is more than just a writing sample. It is an opportunity for you to say, hey, these are my test scores, these are my grades, but this is what kind of person I am, this is what you get. So it's a great opportunity to express yourself. If you are a funny person, you can certainly put humor into your letter, into your essay. If you are not known for your sense of humor, that's probably not the time to start trying that out, okay? So, you do want it to reflect who you are as a person. You do not want your parents to write it. They want it written in your own work. They want it. The admissions counselors will tell us over and over again, we can tell when it's been written by an adult versus a high school student. And they expect that, the writing styles will be different. So, as I said, you can start it. It's okay to have your parents proofread. It's okay to have, and you certainly should have English teachers proofread. And then you just keep going through that process of making corrections, having it proofread again, making corrections until you have a nice clean copy of it. This is the most time-consuming part of the process. Anybody can fill out an application, name, address, telephone number. The most challenging question you're probably going to have is what's your social security number. The essay is the thing that a lot of people wait to do last. I always say start it first. What I would recommend is either use your phone or have a pad of paper in the room that you hang out in most, whether it's your bedroom or wherever, and think about experiences where you learned something about yourself, an obstacle or a challenge you overcame, a person you admire, and why you admire that person. They don't want to read about grandma and grandpa and not learn anything about you in the process. They want to know, I actually had a mission counselor tell me years ago, they use wonderful letters about grandma and grandpa, they'd gladly accept them. You have to bring it back to yourself and say, as a result of my experience with these people, these are my values, my beliefs, my goals, and that type of stuff. So I always say start early. So make notes to yourself, a word, a phrase. It doesn't have to be paragraphs. Just write a bank of information down as these ideas pop into your head. And then when you're ready to sit down over the summer to start your essay, you've got all these thoughts here. And you can start, when you start reading the questions, you can start making, saying this will fit here, this will fit here, and it'll help you in the process. The essay is also one of those things that after you write for a while, you want to put it away and get away from it for a little bit. And then come back to it with a fresh perspective. Do you ever read a passage in a book or a test, and you've read it like three or four times, and at that point you have no idea what you read? It's the same thing with the essay. You really need to kind of take a break and get away from it for a little bit, and then come back with fresh eyes, because you'll read over things and you won't catch mistakes and things like that. So I would start that early, and just keep in mind the essays are usually somewhere between 250 and 650 words. The common application is a maximum of 650 words. You'd be surprised at how quickly you'll fill up those, and it's very hard to cut those down, those essays down, without losing the meaning in here. You may want to talk to a teacher, English teacher, if you have any problem with that. So here's some tips for writing the essay. Focus on using the space to introduce yourself. Tell them a little bit about who you are, what makes you tick, how you think. If you're not sure, ask your parents, ask your friends, ask people that know you best. What do you see in me? What are my strengths? You'd be surprised at some of the feedback that you get, and be helpful in the process when you're writing the essay. And here they are. These are the questions for the Common App for next year. So if you're using the Common Application, you have seven choices. And number seven is a topic of your own choice. Sometimes that scares people, sometimes that's a relief to people. So you have some time to think about it if you're using the Common App and kind of formulating and framing out what you might want to write about. When the Common App, if you have schools that are of the Common App, some schools are Common App exclusive, they've gotten rid of their own applications. Some schools still have their own and they subscribe to the Common App. Some schools do not use the Common App at all. There's probably about 650 schools that are on the Common App now. So if you have at least two schools on the Common App, use the Common App. Even if the school has their own application, you don't get bonus points using their application over the Common Application. If they didn't like the Common App, they wouldn't put their name on it. So why fill out two or three or four or five applications, have to write five different essays when you can do just one? It'll save you a lot of time. Okay. And I have to apologize because we had some technical problems with my PowerPoint this afternoon, so a little part of the end got cut out of it. So before we get to marking calendars on page 11, the college interview process. Has anybody here gone on an interview yet? How about a visit? College visits? Yeah? Oh, good. So here are some tips for you on page 11. If the school does interviews, take advantage of the interview. There's not a lot of schools that do it anymore. A lot of the smaller schools really like to get to know the students that are coming in, and if they have the opportunity, take advantage of it, because they will remember. Admissions counselors are very good in general remembering names and faces, but if they want you in there, they will. That's only going to help you. If you're not sure what you would say in there, we have some sample questions on page 11, questions that you might be asked, questions that you could ask. Remember, when you're going to the interview, this isn't just them trying to find out whether or not they like you and they want you. You're the one that's buying this and paying a lot of money for it. You need to make sure that you're getting the best bang for your buck, and you feel like this is going to be the right environment that you're going to be comfortable in, and you're going to get the experience you really want out of it. So think about it, and once you start visiting schools, you're going to start to notice differences between them. So you might want to ask a question. If you saw something at one school, you don't see it at the next one, ask them if they have that. Or, you know, could you, if it's a club or something, can we start one or something? Whatever it might be. If you're really nervous about an interview, just come in the guidance and we'll help you. We'll do some mock interviews with you. We'll talk it over, what to expect. The question that seems to trip people up, and I mentioned this at the last workshop, which you guys should absolutely be able to nail, is tell us a little bit about yourself. And that trips up everybody, because they're waiting for the academic questions and all this other stuff. And it's not like I'm a straight A student. It's I'm the oldest of two kids. I got a younger sister. I play football. I enjoy playing my guitar in my free time. I like to challenge myself in school. You know, tell them a little bit about who you are, academically, socially, personally. That's what they want to know when they ask that question. Okay. So on page 12, the application and the admissions process. Now is the time to really start to get organized. You may, if you have room in your house to set up a spot for college planning, you may want to put together some folders of different things, different schools, as you start to eliminate schools, get rid of that information. But you're going to want to really try to keep this as organized as possible. And the quick overview of the application process. Generally, this is what the process is. There's the application, the essay, and the fee. Most of this is online now, which means the fee is usually paid by credit card. It is secure. I've never heard in all these years anybody being hacked or their cards being exploited in any kind of way. But those are the things that the applicant is, the student is responsible for. The secondary school report is a combination of the student and the guidance counselor. When you start filling out your common application, the information you plug in there will filter into the school report form, and then once you put our name in there, our email address, we'll be able to fill out our part and send that electronically. Some schools may do it a little bit differently. Some schools may have a paper copy, which you have to write and fill out the top part of it, and then give it to us to fill out the bottom part and send out. So whatever it is, just remember we need to work together to make sure that all your documents get out to the colleges. The recommendations will, in most cases, be sent electronically through Naviance. So teachers will write theirs and upload them in. You guidance counselors will write theirs and we'll upload ours in there. And once we put in your transcript and you're going to fill out all the forms that need to be filled out, we'll click and send it all off. It's instant. When you click and submit your application, it's instant. You'll have a receipt, an electronic receipt, so there's no question about when you sent it. Just caution as far as deadlines go, and I mentioned this before, colleges are very unforgiving when it comes to deadlines. It's not like handing in a paper late to a teacher losing a couple of points on it. In most cases, if you hand in your application late, then you might be more than what you're looking for in a candidate, but there's hundreds of you just like you that are out there, and they have to make a cut someplace, and they'll say thank you, but you've got to take it next year if you want to be applied. So just be very cautious of your deadlines.
And surveys tend to go down right before the deadline.
Yes, that's a very good point. Surveys do tend to go down. Don't wait until 11:59 p.m. on October 31st to get that November 1st. Oh, sorry, November 1st to get the November 1st out. If the survey goes down, they may be a little forgiving in a case like that, but I wouldn't risk that. I would not risk that. So you don't want to rush to send them out because you want to make sure everything is just right and everything's been looked at. The applications should be looked at by the parents. To make sure that, I try to look at the applications if the students want to show me the electronic apps, but I'm not going to catch the wrong birthday or misspelling of something in the events that's more personal nature. So the parents should definitely be checking that part of it. The test scores, this is very important. Test scores have to be sent. If this college wants SATs or ACTs, the student has to go into their College Board account and send those out. You'll be charged, I think it's $12.50 right now to do that. It may go up next year. But the guidance counselors have no access to official transcripts. So that's something that the student has to do. It's not that we don't want to, we just don't have access to them. You're the only one that can release those. So. Make sure when you're submitting your applications that you're also submitting your SAT scores if that's a piece that's being required by the colleges. There are a lot of colleges now that are going SAT optional, or test optional. Naviance will tell you which colleges those are when you're clicking on the admissions qualifications. It'll tell you if they're SAT optional or if they're required. If it says SAT and ACT required, it doesn't mean both, it means one or the other. And I mentioned the early action deadlines, and early decision deadlines start on November 1st, and they usually run the 1st and the 15th of the months. The regular decisions start January 1st, around the 1st and the 15th of the month. Some schools have all of those, some schools have some of those. Again, when you're doing your research, it's important to make sure you know what you're signing up for. Early action is non-binding, you can apply to as many colleges you want for early action, you just find out sooner. Early decision is a binding contract that you are signing, and if you get it, you can only apply to one school early decision. If you get in, that's where you're going. There is some sort of common list that they can refer to. I did have a student going back probably about 10, 12 years ago, who applied early decision to two schools, didn't tell me, Babson and Bryant, and she was being recruited to play tennis. I happened to know the tennis coach at Babson, and he called me to ask about her, and I didn't know that she applied to Babson. I'm like, she applied to Bryant, not Babson. He goes, no, applied early decision to Babson. Well, I kind of kept my mouth shut after that and didn't say anything, but he went back to admissions, talked to admissions, and they checked the list, and sure enough, they found out that she applied both, and she lost both. She was accepted to both and lost both. They rescinded the decisions. So it's serious business on their end. The colleges are businesses. That's how they run. If you have questions, I'm not a big fan of early decision because you're locking yourself in, and I've had students that were 100% sure for the, you know, for the first 3 years of their high school career that this is the school they went to, and then after everything's all said and done, senior year, they end up going someplace else. It's up to you. We will process anything you give us. We just ask that when you're submitting that stuff, you're giving it to us at least 2 weeks before. I would say 3 would be making those requests for transcripts and have all those forms into us at least 3 weeks before. This will guarantee that we don't have to rush and do sloppy work and get everything out in a nice timely way. We'll get everything out if you give it to us last minute, but you know, if you give it to us today and it's due tomorrow, we've got, you know, 5 other students that have stuff ahead of you. We can't guarantee the quality of our letters of recommendation. We don't want to miss the deadline either. So please work with us. If you have a problem with the deadline, it's always better to communicate with us first so we try to work out something so we see it coming before it's just thrown at us. It's a partnership to make sure we're doing this and we're serving everybody the best way we can. Page 13. This is important information that you are going to need to put into your college applications. The school's Middleborough High School CEEB code number, our address, our phone number, fax number, the correct spelling of Mr. Brannigan's name, and your guidance counselor's name, their title, and their contact information. Your class size will be determined in the fall, so don't have to answer that question right now. And your years attended, September 2014 through June of 2018. Make sure you're putting in the correct dates on that. Every year I always find a student, it looks like they've been in high school for 5 years. You're welcome to stay for a bit, right? And your graduation date is going to be June 2nd, 2018. So hold on to this because that's information. All that information is going to go away. When you're filling out your applications, please don't skip questions. I've had students before that have skipped questions. I said, oh, I don't think it was important. If it's on the application, it's important. You can't skip. Okay. That's a reason for them just to throw the application over the draft and say, didn't follow directions. Okay? Every question is important. Page 14. Upcoming events. The college boot camp, as I mentioned earlier, is coming up July 31st, August 4th, or August 7th through 11th. There'll be guidance counselors and English teachers here to help you finalize your essays and get those applications just right before school starts, so it's one less thing you have to worry about. Then we're going to have our college planning night for seniors and their parents, and then, like I said, it's the nuts and bolts of applying to college. That's in September. And then in October, we will have our financial aid night. We have an expert come in because financial aid is very complex and constantly changing, and we wouldn't do it justice if we tried to present on that. So we do have an expert come in every year to talk about the best way to prepare, the FAFSA and all that stuff. For those of you who are thinking scholarships, the scholarship process really doesn't start until, believe it or not, March. I'm actually the scholarship coordinator, and the booklet came out came out, I think it was the first or second week of March this year. That's because we were relying on all the sponsors out there to get information to us, and it's a very short window. I believe the deadline was April 11th, to have everything sent in, and the deadline for the sponsors to let us know was last week, and I'm still chasing people, so, but we have our scholarship night coming up, so it's a very quick time. I can tell you right now, there was a lot of money left on the table this year. Thousands and thousands of dollars left on the table because people just didn't apply. There were scholarships out there that one person applied for. And they weren't, I know people in this building that, when you look at the description of that scholarship, had more of the qualifications than that person, but they weren't going to apply, so good for them. So once that information comes out, it's a lot of money out there if you take the time. So we'll be letting you know about that, so don't worry about financial aid and scholarships right now. Let's get through the college search and the college applications, and we will guide you through the rest of it as to, and let you know when it's time to start making that next move. If you happen to come across a scholarship that's not through our local scholarships here, and there's an early deadline, just bring it in to us, and guidance counselor will fill out the piece that you want for you. In the back, sample forms are the letter of recommendation information for teacher, so you can see what those questions are. And then the next page is for the guidance counselor, and then the updated activity sheet is on page 6. And the activity sheet we actually filled out to show you how, what to put in there and how to word things. Don't be shy, don't be bashful. For those of you who babysit, that is a job. It's a job with a lot of responsibility. I always have, and it's mostly girls, not a stereotype. They say, oh, do you have a job? No, well, I babysit, I just babysit. That's an important job. That's a higher responsibility job. So that should be included under employment if you do that. Make sure that you're not shortchanging yourself and that you're letting us know what you do, because all this information is going to be helpful in getting you into the school of your choice. And then finally, in the back of all the books, we have a glossary of terms. If you come across a term that's not in here, tell us and we'll add it in here. But this is a pretty comprehensive list, whether it's just college terms or acronyms that tend to be used in education. We'll help answer some questions. And then in the back of the book is a section if you just want to take notes, go through the process. And that's the presentation, but I am willing to take questions at this point. I know it was a lot of information. I wanted to go over this. The other one I kind of said, kind of take a look at it, we get to the panel discussion. But this is the stuff that really kind of organizes you and gets you on track to make sure that you're moving at the right pace through the process. So are there questions out there? Is there something?
So the teacher recommendation, the guidance recommendation,
they'll be able to see that it was done, okay? It'll say initial material submitted, which means we can't send just one piece. Everything that college requires, the transcript, the school report, the letter of recommendation, if they require, whatever they require, we cannot send it. We can click, but it won't send until all those documents are uploaded in. So it'll say initial materials sent, and then at the mid-year, it'll say mid-year grade sent. And then at the end, which we will do after graduation, we'll say final grade sent. And that goes just to one college, wherever you put your deposit down. Some of the teachers share their recommendations with students that they ask. A lot don't. I don't think I know any guidance counselors that ever shared their letters of recommendation. And the reason for that is you're going to have the option on the Common App, on all applications, to check waiving your right to privacy. And the colleges really like to see the students waiving their right to view those letters. And the reason for that is the colleges are getting, but they you're telling the colleges, you're getting an honest reference here, because I haven't seen it. And the question that always comes up from the student is, well, how do I know if the teacher's going to write, or the guidance counselor's going to write something bad about me? I've been guidance counselor for 19 years, and I have never put a negative comment in a letter of recommendation. If there is something about a student that I'm not fond of, I leave that out. okay? And I think I've had maybe two students in 19 years where I had to kind of be a little bit careful how I worded things, but my job is to try to help them get into school, and I'm not gonna get in the way of that. And if it's hard for teachers go, if you have any doubt whatsoever, a teacher would possibly say something negative, go and ask that teacher. If the teachers feel like they can't provide what they would feel would be a really valuable letter, they'll suggest we ask somebody else. The guidance counselors have the right, because it's the official school.
You can see that it's been done.
You can see that it's been done, it's been sent, correct. Other questions? Yes?
But you take the SAT in June, and then you recommend that they take it again?
Yes.
Later in the fall. You think it's better on the June one, is that what goes to school?
You get to pick which one you want to send. So if you take them twice, you do better on the first one, and you do the second one, send the first one. If you did better on the evidence-based reading and writing in the first one, but you did better on the math in the second one, send both, and they'll super score it. They'll take the best scores from each one, they'll combine them together.
If you do worse, and you have to send, and I want to see all of them, mm-hmm. some colleges do, how will that negatively impact?
Well, it's actually an interesting question. The question was, if you send both, because the college is requiring it, then send all of them. Will it negatively impact if one is lower than the other? Depending on how low it is, if it's a little bit lower, no, because I realize it's like a margin of error in there also. But if you take the SATs 3-4 times, which I would not recommend doing, and you have one score that's here and two or three that are over here, that's where it can negatively impact you, because now all of a sudden they're saying, did you get lucky? If you can't get lucky in SATs, why is this one here and the rest of them here? Is this more what the student really like? So that's why I always say, you know, more is not better with the SATs. The College Board's own statistics show that of all the students that take it a second time without significant preparation, only about 33% of them will show a marked improvement. And of that group that decided to take it a third time without any significant preparation, a third of those students won't show marked improvement. So you can see those numbers drop significantly each time. So if you've taken them once, you've taken them twice, you're not happy with either set, I would try an ACT at that point. The ACTs are set up a little bit differently. It's English, math, science, reasoning, reading, and there's an optional writing section in it too. And sometimes students just do a little bit better luck because they're just set up a little bit differently.
My son is only taking 4 AP classes next year, and they don't get their grades for that until the summer.
So only?
Yeah. So how will they get the grades for that?
Oh, so he'll be graduated. Yeah, the school's going after he graduates, right. So puts his deposit down.
Yeah.
Yes. So the question is, the son's going to be taking only four AP courses. And by the time the AP scores come out in July, he would have already put a deposit down at the college he's planning on attending. So how do they get those scores? He'll be able to access those scores through College Board and have them send them to the colleges. And then, depending on how he scored, he may get 3 credits, 6 credits, depending on the college and what he got for the score of the test. Usually you won't get any credits if it's below a 3.
How will it like affect his GPA?
The AP test wouldn't affect
really
his GPA.
Right?
Classwork, it's what he does in the class, okay. That is what he's going to be graded on. The AP test is separate.
Okay. I have another question. Is there a score on the SAT that you would, if they receive a certain score, would you recommend that they don't bother taking a second one? Or would you always recommend?
I think that's a case-by-case basis. Would I recommend not taking it a second SAT if somebody got a certain score on the first SAT? Well, if they got a perfect 1600, I would say there's no need to go there. I think it's a combination of how high the score is and what schools the student's applying to. Because a really good SAT score, you know, might not be good enough to get in Harvard, you know. So it really depends, because it would be a case-by-case basis. In the back.
How is the GPA calculated? I know that re-weight our AP classes, but I read that the colleges don't, they don't weight them. So how do you figure that out?
Okay, there's two different things that happen. We have an unweighted grade point average here at the high school. So everything is, an A is an A is an A, doesn't matter what level it is. Our class rank is weighted. So this way we don't have like four people tied for number one. So that does separate people out. So we report that in the school report form, exactly what, you know, what's weighted, what's unweighted, and all that, so they understand that. Every high school does it differently. Every high school has a different scale. So what the colleges tend to do is they will say, that's nice. The colleges are familiar with the schools in their area, okay? You know, we send a lot of people to Bridgewater and UMass Dartmouth. They're very familiar with us. They know what our school is about. They know what our system is about, and the type of student that comes out of Middleborough High School. You know, people that live in Randolph or Dorchester, Braintree, they have a lot of people who go to UMass Boston. They're very familiar with those schools in that area and what they do. So what colleges do is they understand the local schools and what they what they're all about and everything. But most colleges will recalculate the grade point average using their own scale. So they'll see our scale, so they get a sense of what it means. But what they'll do is they'll say, okay, on our scale, and I'm just throwing out numbers, an AP course is going to be a 5.5. Okay, and an honors course is going to be a 5, and a college prep course is going to be a 4. And it'll trickle it down that way. And they will weight it. So now everybody coming from all over the country, all over the world, really, from all these different scales, will go into their scale. UMass Amherst, I know what they do is they'll see, oh, you took psychology as an elective, you got an A. You took sociology as an elective, and you got a... you got a B plus. They will average those two scores together, and they'll give you an A minus, okay? And they'll say, oh, look, they were honors courses. We'll give you an extra half a point for that also. So they try to be fair with it. There are a few colleges out there. I don't know if they still do it. I think it's Delaware. Only look at academic courses, the core academics, English, math, social science, language. Doesn't matter if you took AP marketing or if you took some other academically based course that's not in one of those disciplines. That's how they measure. So they all have their different philosophies, but in general, the colleges are pretty fair, and they do try to put everything that makes sense out of it, and put everybody on the same level.
So there is a benefit for them to take AP then.
If they do well, it's a benefit.
Oh,
yes. I mean, I had a student several years ago that took 5 AP courses in 1 year. It was a 7-period schedule. And he was a very smart kid, but he was also a very lazy kid, and he got C's. It didn't matter if he took AP honors or college prep, he always got C's. He did enough work to keep his parents and his teachers off his back. And applied to UMass Amherst. And at the time, UMass is harder to get into now than it was then, but back then it was a 3.0 and 1,000 SAT got to UMass. And he had SAT scores, high sixes. So he was way up there. But then they saw his grade point average, which was like a 2.5, and they saw that he had all these AP courses that he got C's in, and they actually rejected him. And I remember him and his mom in my office saying, I don't get it, they were all AP courses. I said, yeah, but they saw your SAT scores, and they were showing them you were an underachiever, too. It's balanced, you know. If you're not an AP student, if you got a challenge with an AP course, make sure it's the right AP course, first of all. You don't want to take AP chemistry if you have very low math skills. It might not be the right one. You might want to look at your BB English instead. But it's a balancing act, okay? Some students, maybe 1 or 2 APs is appropriate. Others, maybe 4 or 5 is appropriate over the course of a high school career. You gotta ask yourself at the end of the day, what kind of picture am I painting for these colleges? What are they looking for? Because they're looking for people that have a good sense of who they are academically. They're gonna challenge themselves, but not overwhelm themselves. Because the one thing a college also doesn't want to do is report a dropout rate. It's not good for their business. So it's it's a balancing act. And also, if you take the AP exam, you're gonna, you know, most of the students taking it, not just for the experience of AP, but they want to get credit for it too. So, you know, there's no exact formula for it, and it depends on what you're looking for, the experience or the credit. Other questions? In the back?
What if your children aren't gonna be around for the summer?
What if your children are not gonna be around, we're talking about the boot camp?
Yeah.
That's okay, we'll catch them up.
Yeah?
Yeah, if they can do what we talked about in the workbook tonight, and start their applications and start framing out their essay, they will be fine. Okay? If they're looking at applying early, like November 1st, November 15th, I'd probably have them see their guidance counselor sooner than later, just to make sure that they are caught up on everything, okay? But again, the timelines that we put in this book, we'll put together without the boot camp even in mind. What else? Well, I'll be here for a little bit, so if people have more personal questions they want to ask, I will be up here. Thank you all for coming out. We really appreciate it. It was a busy time of year. Call us if you have any questions.